I want to really welcome everyone. My name is Manish, and I'm based in Rajasthan, India, and have been involved with Ecoversity since the beginning. I helped to start the Swaraj University here in Udaipur 10 years ago, and a few years ago, the Jail University, and this past year, the Complexity University, and also this past year, the Tribal Youth Ecoversity. So, been doing this for a while, and we've been supporting a lot of projects in India, also all over the country, people doing it all over the world. So I'm excited to be with you all. I'm going to ask, Kareem and I are doing this together, and I'm going to ask Kareem to introduce himself a little bit.
Okay, so very briefly, I'm currently sitting on a balcony in Fatimid Cairo, medieval Cairo, looking at a mosque from the 14th century, surrounded by buildings from about 1,000 years ago, inside an autonomous liberal arts college, a micro college that I set up in 2013, and that I continue to be involved with as an educator, scholar, activist, trickster, as Manish likes to say, and community organizer around here.
Someone asked in the chat, what is Ecoversity and what defines one?
So we've kept the definition of Ecoversity purposely blurred, and it's really emerging all over the world, all kinds of forms and shapes. There's the spaces for learning, unlearning, exploring self, exploring purpose, exploring how to create new worlds that we dream of. And there's, you know, forest ecoversities, river ecoversities, mountain ecoversities, jail, prison ecoversities, eco-village ecoversities, traditional village ecoversities, urban ashram ecoversities. One of the things I found most beautiful is that it's defying definition, and we've had lots of internal discussions, some people saying we need to define it very clearly, and others feeling that rather than we defining, it's defining. Actually, this whole movement is actually shaping and defining us. We're trying to make sense of what's happening on the planet and all of these beautiful things that are popping up all over all these different spaces and communities. But one thing we've kept is that, you know, these are spaces that are working with higher education, meaning with 16, 17 plus. But even if I say that, there's a lot of spaces which have chosen to see themselves as intergenerational spaces as a kind of core philosophy. So there are spaces which are, you know, both adults and children are involved in, and grandparents. So I think the idea is that there is kind of been a set of critiques that have emerged over the last 100 years around the formal university setup. Those have become stronger, particularly over the last year with COVID. The space of ecoversities are people who are outside of the formal university structures and trying to create and define what the university means to us. It's up to now, the idea of university has been defined. Even as in India, for example, there's a University Grants Commission, and that defines what is a university and what is not. So part of a kind of more radical political project that we've taken in India is that no, communities will define what constitutes a university or an ecoversity. And so we've kept that open like that. There's this very strong spirit of creativity and play. People are really trying to create these different spaces for healing, for hospitality, for creativity, for localization, for many, many different things. And part of the beautiful thing of the Alliance is the kind of intercultural dialogue that is happening amongst all of these different kinds of spaces. And one of the things I think that shocked me initially was we assumed that, oh, these are all our people, this is our tribe, these are all the alternatives. And while that's true, there's so much diversity even within that, which is, I think, is both amazing and has also been quite challenging as we've tried to kind of build an alliance of people with all different kinds of visions for how education can look and serve their communities. So I want to invite Kareem to say a few words more, and then we are going to jump into a little few exercises to try to imagine and talk about the kind of ecoversities that are within us and waiting to be birthed into the world.
So Manish assigned me 5 to 7 minutes. I'm going to use the first 2 minutes to pick up my laptop and like show you around, give you some impressions of this Ecoversity project, CELAS, Cairo Institute of Liberal Arts and Sciences. I can share the website link in the chat in a moment. But as I was just mentioning, I'm in historical Cairo. So like the built environment is pretty exciting. So I just want to give you a sense of an Ecoversity that is like urban based or city based, which we're a minority, but I still believe in us urban Ecoversities. Okay, so this is one of the classrooms slash dining tables turned into a classroom. This is the media lab slash library space. I don't know if that is helpful. Okay, and then I'll just quickly run up to the roof with you. On the way up, I'm showing you the sign of the Cairo Institute of Liberal Arts and Sciences. All right. Is this fun? Action-based. Action. We're going to be talking about action-based research. This is action-based presenting. Whoa, it's way too sunny. Sorry for everyone who is in a cold part of the world. Sorry, Nico. Anyway, so this is the roof. Once again, kind of a sense of the city, which is kind of important to the story I'm telling. And then behind me, a very famous mosque, one of the oldest mosques from the 14th century, Sultan Hassan, if you want to look it up. Okay. All right. So as I'm going back down, I mean, Manish already mentioned that the notion of an ecoversity is nowhere defined or set in stone or coined in an academic paper or anything. So it's pretty loose, shall we say. And still, I really like remembering the words of a dear comrade and co-founder of the Alliance, Kelly Teeny, and her partner Udi, who are currently in Hawaii and were also been involved with the Alliance since the beginning. And Kelly always reminds us that an ecoversity is obviously about our shared concern with ecological collapse, but it's also about the notion of home. So the ancient Greek word that eco derives from is also the household or the home. And so she talks a lot about homecoming or returning home. And to us here in Cairo, that has meant keeping people here at home rather than sort of like sending them overseas to study in Europe, UK or North America. So providing the opportunity for them to kind of engage with the liberal arts, the humanities, and social sciences critically at a like an affordable cost, and not necessarily having to earn a scholarship to go to a colonial institution abroad. So I like to start kind of emphasizing this notion of home. The other thing that I can offer you in these first couple of minutes is an image. One moment, I'm going to share the screen. Okay, so yes. This is an image I wanted to share with you of a pigeon tower or a dove cote sometimes, which is a metaphor. This is very common in the countryside, and not only in Egypt, but across North Africa and West Asia, all the way until Iran, even further into Asia. Okay, so you saw that image. I've used the image of an ivory tower to kind of help us help our minds kind of steer away from the ivory tower, which at the metaphorical level still very much dominates our imagination of the higher educational landscape. Everyone has different associations with the ivory tower, but it's usually what comes up for people is that it's, you know, like high up there, it's very theoretical, it's kind of detached or disconnected from everyday lives on, you know, in the streets and on the ground. The other thing that kind of comes up for many people, especially with the neoliberal turn or the neoliberal assault on universities, is that they're increasingly like walled in or gated. And the other thing is that it's very much sort of competitive or competition based, and like you have to prove yourself as an individual within that system or within the ivory tower. So with the pigeon tower, I kind of wanted to sort of like remind us of how beautiful pigeons are, first and foremost, and how collectively they act and as flocks, and they learn and, you know, navigate the skies as a community. So kind of like emphasize this community-based approach to higher education, as well as recognize kind of the materiality of the pigeon tower, which is something made from mud brick, very much kind of like fragile and exposed to the kind of the climate. And finally, also the fact that pigeon towers are very much embedded in their surrounding. So I use this image to talk about what we do out here at CELUS, which is very much that. It's very much embedded, as I just showed you, situated in a neighborhood, which is both kind of a historical neighborhood, but it's also very much a popular neighborhood. There's some precarious housing around us, very precarious infrastructure, pipes breaking pretty regularly. Internet connection is not great. I'm on a my friend's hotspot, because it wouldn't have been enough to use the internet connection. And very much taking a very community-based approach and learning in small groups around that dining table I showed you in the beginning. Taking a discussion-based approach to learning and engaging with different materials, not text and sound and visuals and artifacts and so on. So that's the first kind of image I wanted to present you with. And the other thing is a little bit more, another visual, but a little bit more for orientation purpose. I'm going to share the screen for a second. The Ecoversities Alliance has different working committees. And last summer, as part of the Germinator working committee, which gives out seed funding and advice to people who want to set up an Ecoversity, I offered a webinar and just kind of like drew by hand this little compass of higher education, which I'm going to very briefly in like a minute or two guide you through. So let me maybe start in the top right quadrant where it says modern colonial university, very much for profit, which is your neoliberal university I just mentioned, or as you can see on the right, the a corporate academic institution in terms of its makeup or its configuration. And then at the bottom left quadrant, there's the decolonial Ecoversity, which is what we're here to talk about. And sort of along the way, you traditionally have the nonprofit status, which actually most universities have. And then at the bottom left, along the diagonal, like purple axis, there's an allied cooperative, which is how I understand CELUS and Swaraj and other places in the alliance to be allied, in the sense that we're in an alliance and cooperative in that we take decisions collectively. The other thing that is maybe interesting to mention is in terms of the entity itself, on the very left along the horizontal axis, it says self-sufficient collective, be it more artistic like Nico's work in St. Petersburg, or scholarly like perhaps the work we're doing here in Cairo, or a learning collective or learning community like many other places. But this notion of self-sufficiency, or more recently I talk about autonomy, like an autonomous collective. And then finally along the vertical axis, generally in modern colonial university, there's still very much this idea of a pedagogy of consumption, of clientelism, where people are made to pay a lot and then to consume information or knowledge. People talk about the commodification of knowledge as well. Anyways, as you kind of work your way down, there's increasingly talk of pedagogies of discovery. So we're coming to learn together. And then as you travel further down, this, I also find this notion of a pedagogy of attunement interesting, where you try and sort of like situate yourself, be place-based, see what's going on around you, see how you can attend to a call, be more responsive, more responsible. I hope that these two images or visuals were sort of more enticing than complicating matters for you as you go into the questions.
What we are going to do is ask you to, we're going to do a kind of quick fire rounds, like 4 minutes each with a partner, and one person will speak for 2 minutes and the other person will listen deeply. And what we call Buddha listening in Swaraj University. And then the second 2 minutes, the other person will speak. And we invite you to speak from your heart, from a space of freedom, of creativity, of not trying to get it perfect or right, but to be in the flow. And also, I want to just ask everyone to kind of close our eyes for this kind of these few rounds for a minute, and just kind of really center in the space and really invite. I mean, for me, this there is a kind of I don't know how to name it, but there's a higher energy. There's some energy that is guiding all of these Ecoversities and that is birthing them. And I would like to just invite that energy into us, into this session with us and into each of us. You know, we can say for short from the goddess of the Ecoversity, let the goddess let us, you know, guide us and be with us as we go through this process. So maybe take 30 seconds and close your eyes and invite the goddess in your own way into the session with us, to help us create and imagine and give birth to something very magical. And if there's resistance, just notice that resistance and give that resistance a hug as well. So I invite you to take 3 deep breaths before we start. Take it in, release. In. Release. And release. And don't be afraid. We're not here to get the right answer. It's not an exam. It's not a, we're trying to liberate ourselves from all of these traumas that we had to go through. But to see what wants to emerge, just to hold the space for something beautiful to emerge. So I see oftentimes the work I do and many others in the Alliance, we're just vehicles for these energies to flow. So the first round is I want you to talk about a dream for an Ecoversity that you're holding, for a space of learning or unlearning or healing or connecting, reconnecting to home. Yeah. So whatever that space is that you're holding, just share a little bit about that dream. You may have thought about the dream, or the dream may just start flowing through you right now with the question. So just be open with that. And I want you to kind of think of a name for your Ecoversity and just name it, whatever it is. The name can change or over time, it may change and evolve, but for the moment, for the purpose of our time together, just name it. So I think, you know, that dream of what it can be might have something of what people would come there to kind of learn and unlearn and explore. I think the process of naming has been very important for us in our work in India, and a lot of the names we have tried to create names and stories which really resonate with people. Like one of the things when we started, at least in India, people were like, oh, is this another hippie thing from the West or something, or is this something that's grounded in our soil? So we said that, you know, our Swaraj University, we said that Our first vice chancellor was 4,000 years ago. There's a story of a self-designed learner named Eklavya. So we said this is our first idea of this Ecoversity came 4,000 years ago. And so that has helped a lot for people to kind of breathe easy and to see this as something that is, you know, rooted, something that's connected to our own wisdom traditions and our cultural traditions. So in terms of naming, I think it's a very powerful process, and we can really look for names which are connected to maybe stories also, even which embody or illustrate some of the spirit of what we're trying to create. It's a really, you know, people get hung up on names. I know it's really tough, but particularly with all this branding culture, but I invite you to unbrand a little bit and be free play. It's a process of really testing out different things, you know, so testing out names, seeing does it all of a sudden, you know, when somebody hears that name, is there a spark that you feel from that person, an excitement to want to know more? So I would say take anything and test it out, and then it'll be starting conversations and starting to let energy flow around this thing. So don't get so caught up that it has to be the right name at the beginning.
Also, there's always the possibility of renaming and for actually the people to subvert the name. So I call the space out here Cairo Institute of Liberal Arts and Sciences, just to mock my friend who preferred to be at MIT, Massachusetts Institute of Technology. So that's how the name came about, more of a mockery. And then the acronym CELAS was taken up by the students and they turned it into CELASians as people who come to the space. But also kind of like did away with the name altogether and subverted it. So I think names can always be reappropriated or like renamed or subverted in that way. Okay.
The second question is around what is the need of your Ecoversity in the world today? Why do you think this idea that you're holding is needed in the world today? Again, you don't have to over-intellectualize it, but whatever you see as a need, so a lot of what our experience with Ecoversity is, it's and its emergence and trying to establish a new kind of space. So one option, and some Ecoversities have done that, they've gone for, you know, formal state recognition and all of that. And Swaraj, we've chosen to be 100% illegal and share that, but really build ourselves on stories, and that's where people connect. So these things are really what I'm asking is to help hopefully bring out stories from you to engage with people.
I was with Vision and I loved how diverse our approaches were, each catered to the specific situation we're in and surrounding and people we work with. And I loved that, to feel that diversity with the same source.
Great, thank you, Floris. Why is this project important to you personally? Like, how does this connect to your own story? Why are you the person who has to be helping to give birth to this project? Like, why is it incredibly important to you? I would like to talk about it. It's not about the other, saving the other. Hopefully we can move beyond these, you know, white man burden, civilizational, saving the natives kind of narratives and actually connect it to our own, like for me, going to the jail university has been one of the most spiritual fulfilling activities I've been involved in explorations. And so it's for me, it's, I can go on and on how it's been really important for my own journey. For we put together a little, in India, a little startup kit for people who want to create Ecoversities. So that might be something that will help you and as you go forward. Our own personal stories are really, really matter in this process. So I remember one of the most powerful things, one of the co-founders of with me, Reva Dundige of Swaraj, she talked a lot about when she was in 12th, some of her friends committed suicide and she was also failed. And this was one of the main motivations for wanting to come together and start Swaraj University. and things. And every time I hear her speak about it, it gives me goosebumps and to why. And then I have my own lots of childhood trauma and explorations both that also gave me lots of visions for why to start Swaraj. So I think the more we bring in our personal stories as we kind of try to describe what is the Ecoversity we want to create and why we want to create it, the more powerful it becomes. Really, we talk a lot about this idea of prototyping. And the idea is like, you know, that we are living in such crazy, unpredictable, uncertain times that if we think we've created the formula, the model for the world, we are at some point going to be rudely shaken. And there is no one model and there is no one magic formula for doing this. And so the idea is that we keep testing and making sense. Even in Swaraj, it's a 10-year journey. I can say that the young people we worked with 10 years ago and the people now, they have very different needs. Many different things are happening and have emerged in the world in 10 years. So I think we need to keep testing out things. I think a lot of people get stuck, I've seen, like trying to come up with the perfect plan, with the perfect funding model, with the perfect governance model. And that usually ends up dying a long death on a piece of paper or in a Microsoft document and things. And so what our approach has been really to go out and test out. So start out by testing out the name, test out the stories around that, and maybe test out some offerings. So it could be a little workshop. It could be an invitation to a conversation. It could be an experiential journey. It could be some posters, but something that you would like to do to test out and start to create a field. I think some people have used the word field of learning. So kind of create a field for this energy to kind of start moving. Let's imagine that it's being born today and it's ready to launch. And we don't need to get permission from anybody to launch it. That's one thing I think I have to keep reminding myself and friends is that we don't need permission from anyone. We can launch it. What would be one thing, a little prototype you would like to test out and do in the next coming weeks? Something you can do for your Ecoversity to start to share it with the world. And it doesn't have to be big. It can be very small, but it's just taking these step by step. And, you know, there's a famous saying, we make the road by walking it. So that's kind of the spirit of this, is that, you know, start walking and the road will appear and our Ecoversities will take shape. People who are, whether they're vice chancellors or professors, oftentimes would be like, oh, okay, that's nice, and kind of give this look that, oh, that's cute. You know, that's a little cute project. They would listen for 5 minutes. I'm sure many have felt that. As soon as we started saying Swaraj University, the whole conversation, the energy, the body language, the attentiveness shifted. And, you know, what would usually be a 5-minute conversation turned into 2-hour conversations and very deep reflections by those people about their own projects. So I found that one of the reasons of naming it an Ecoversity or a university is really to create a much more legitimate space for dialogue with people who are trapped in current systems, and also a space for dialogue with parents and people who have been, you know, traumatized by the system as well, learners. So like with the jail university, again, inmates saying that, oh, I don't have a degree, and some saying, I don't even know how to read and write. How can I join the jail university? And we're like, no, you're welcome to join. And you can just see a radical shift in their whole, you know, their whole body language and their own approach once they say, oh, we can be part of something like this. So I think there's a lot in a lot has been opened up in terms of building legitimacy, building trust, building new kinds of relationships. So I encourage you to test it out in your own communities and with the language of these and the naming, and see what happens.
One of the things that I noticed from the session is, and that I also really care about much, is that metaphors matter. So I presented the metaphor of the pigeon tower, which is kind of very specific to this context. But then somebody commented in the chat about a beehive, which I think is lovely. And then in the there's a baby. Okay. And then there was in the breakout room, somebody mentioned a coral reef. And I think all of these images are really, really lovely and could sort of guide or work as a vehicle, as Manish was saying. So metaphors do matter. And the second thing is, I mean, my background is in urbanism. I learned how to appreciate and read spaces and how they change the built environment and all of that. So I think space is very, very, very key. And learning how to read space, where to situate yourself, what's going on around you if you were to situate yourself in that, what is going to happen if your space comes alive and it's going to radiate around you, what's happening to the neighborhood. And think there's a word in Arabic that's very, very nice. It's called mjawra. And actually, it's borrowed from a Palestinian educator, an elder who's also part of the Ecoversities Alliance called Munir Fashe. And he talks about the notion of neighborliness and sort of like embeddedness within a neighborhood. I think that's something to consider, be it in a rural context or in an urban context, where to situate. Obviously, the whole idea of emplacement or place-based learning is somehow, you know, going in that direction as well. And then finally, one of the things, Manish jokingly said, like, we're 100% illegal. Now, here at Silas in Cairo, we can't afford to be 100% illegal because we live under a dictatorial regime. So if we do, you know, like illegal shit, we'll end up in jail. So and not the kind of like jail university, but like the kind of jail where you just disappear into a black hole for a while. I don't want to risk that. So there is the question of like a legal form or legal status. Like, are you going to be a nonprofit, like an NGO? Are you going to be a for-profit but operate as a social enterprise? Does your country and the legal context allow for a cooperative to be registered as such, community-based organizations? It really depends. And that also depends on the state or province or where you are. So this is an important question, I think, because it will have an effect on how you can generate income and redistribute income so that you can employ people, maybe hire people, form a team that can actually live, perhaps even, I mean, only part-time off this work somehow also. So how do we do that? How do we rebel? Cooperativa Cacao in Oaxaca has this whole feel around rebeldía and how to rebel, but to do that in a smart way.
Great. Thank you, Karim. Yeah, I think just adding on to what you're saying, you know, these questions, this is an ongoing, I think, dialogue within the Ecoversities Alliance also around, you know, degrees and diplomas and where people situate themselves. We have in Swaraj, we've been working for the last 10 years on a campaign healing ourselves from the diploma disease, and we actually are quite anti-diploma and degrees, whereas other members in the Ecoversities Alliance are, again, depending on their context, they've even formed formal relationships with, you know, degree-granting bodies, and they're giving out degrees. So I think this is a friendly debate, dialogue that continues within the Alliance. And everyone, I think the understanding is everyone is trying to figure out what they can do creatively in their own context. Also, you know, this issue of what you mentioned, the campus, you know, there's a lot of ways we have, again, idea of what a campus might look like, but there can be all kinds of spaces, a forest or a park. I know people who are having their campus under a bridge. They have it at a cafe. Once we start to tell the stories about this, there's lots of places which can be reclaimed as spaces of learning and connection, and you don't need to have a 100-acre campus and a huge fund to run that and all that. And I have had, actually, now in India we have more than 25 quote unquote campuses. People have plots of land. They've offered when you can come and have your programs of Swaraj University. So I found that there's a lot of spaces sitting around, and people get excited about the idea. There's whole different ways to negotiate what a campus can look like. And the last thing I think is just the issue of price and pricing and how you see money system, a commodification and all of that. And so we've run it in Swaraj. We've been exploring for the last 10 years the idea of the gift culture. solidarity economy. We're also exploring that with many people in many different eco-versities are exploring that in different ways, that how do we not first enslave young people into the debt regime, the global debt regime, and how do we actually not fall into this idea of making things so expensive that most people cannot afford them. And yet, how do we at the same time honor all the effort and contributions and gifts that people put into making this happen?
This healing from the diploma disease campaign that you did in India is brilliant. And I really invite everyone to check out the Shikshantar website and like read up on it. But perhaps on this note, you know, like adopting an anti-credentialist stance, you know, and like doing away with the whole like accreditation and the overly costly, you know, quality assuring bodies and all of that, invites us to just mock the system. And Gustavo Esteva has a really lovely piece, you know, where he reflects on Unitierra in Oaxaca, saying, it's like, let's take this diploma and just kind of like, you know, do something fun with it, like, you know, make it look fun and just like mock the very piece of paper. So mockery is just such a very powerful tool that we can use as creators.
Yeah, so I think that's the spirit is, I think, again, what you're saying, playfulness is what is at the heart of all of this work, and really love, people are typing that in, love revolution and care, pedagogy of care. So art, I see at the start, and Kareem and I see it as a start of a conversation with you guys. So I invite all of you to continue exploring this with us. We'd love to support you in some way to keep your project growing and evolving and breathing in the world.